What's going on, guys? Good morning. Welcome back to Everyday Struggle. Finally, I'm Nadeska here with DJ Akademiks and our guy Wayno.
What's good?
What's going on, man? It feels like the first day of school.
What's the deal? We got
like, we've been off for a year.
Stop it.
Hey, man, I was just telling my man Wayno, man, fuck all that, man. 2018, man. What? Summer body act is coming in, man. He just told me he's in like in a Taibo class.
You're not gonna do that.
He's just making shit up.
He's making shit up. Muay Thai class.
Same thing.
Martial arts, jujitsu, jiu-jitsu, all of that.
Listen, because you know what I mean, this year or this summer, I don't want to hire too many security. I want to hire one security that the other guy that pull up on me, I can wash him.
Yeah, so, all right.
Yo, the most non-athletic dude I've ever met in my life.
Bruh, I'm definitely starting a diet today. Not even a diet, a workout plan.
All right, y'all. We'll see what's good.
I'm going to eat the same stuff. Same stuff. Workout.
All right.
But I'm glad to still want hip hop. Never want a hip hop diet.
All right, yeah, so we're back. Look, it's been a minute. Of course, we missed a lot. I feel like everyone dropped an album while we were gone. Kanye came back. But let's start with Meek Mill, man. Let's start with the best news. So, of course, he was released from prison on April 25th. He had a pretty big homecoming. And after that, he's been really busy. So he performed at Rolling Loud in Miami. He's going to perform at Summer Jam. But he's been focusing a lot of his energy in his interviews, like his Dateline special, on addressing the need to reform our criminal justice system. Mm. What do you guys think about the way Meek has handled things since he's been out of prison?
Meek is killing this shit, man. I gotta say, Meek is doing exactly what he should do given the amount of support he got while he was in jail. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people rallied behind him, not only because he was a celebrity, and that was a thing for a lot of people. Even me, I was looking like, are we only saying free this guy and we're going hard because we love his music, or do we really think he is getting taken advantage of? And clearly, we saw a lot of signs and evidence that he was. So when he's out now, You gotta pay it forward. And you know what I mean? He said, I heard him say some of the best stuff. He said, listen, yeah, I had 7 lawyers. It cost me a couple mil, but I had 7 lawyers.
Right.
And I'm famous. I have these friends that could rally together to make things happen and make sure I got a fair shake. There's a bunch of people that don't have it, so I gotta be their voice. I commend him for that. I'm glad he also said that, yeah, he's still that guy who gave us the music from before, even though he's focused on other things. I think he's doing a tremendous job now, and I'm happy for him.
Yeah, Meek is like, I said it before, like he's one of the new young kings. He's one of the new young kings within hip hop. To see him go through all of this shit is unsettling, you know what I'm saying? But he's building a voice for people who can't be heard. Like you said, like he doesn't have, people inside don't have the same resources he has. So, I mean, just his trajectory of where he's been, because everybody thought he was going to be done for more than one or two things. Now he's in a place where he's grown up. Mm-hmm. Like, this is 31-year-old Meek. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and he's showing it through his actions. And I can't, like, the music, I'm going to chill. We're going to chill on.
But he said the music is coming. We know it's coming.
Yeah,
but it's just cool that he's taking on a much bigger fight now that he has this voice. It's important.
Go ahead, Mahal.
I'm going to definitely say, though, I'm watching him outside of that. He's doing, he got to do the round. So he got to do the NBCs. He got to be the person who's standing with the mayor, the governor. Yo, listen, we need criminal reform, we need justice reform, good. But he said something, he had an interview, and he said, listen, I've changed people around me. I'm now removing myself from situations that could get me in those predicaments that I was just in, even if I was innocent in the first place. And I'm going to hold him to that.
Yeah.
I'm going to hold him to that. Yeah. Because, again, I heard the same interview or kind of the same sentiment being given out when he did his last press run. And he was like, yo, I've changed. He talked about drugs, getting off drugs the last time, and he still went to jail. So I'm watching how Meek moves. I think he should know that with all the support, you're kind of put back on a higher level. Like, niggas was at one point saying, Meek is done. Meek is not done. You get me?
Nah.
Meek at this point, and again, Boosie said it. Boosie said it on Everyday Show. He said, sometimes jail and prison could actually put your career on an anticipation level where people are like, yo, we don't see you all the time on Instagram. Yeah. We want you now. I'm hoping to see Meek Mill actions where he's not around certain things. No more hopping out Suburbans when dudes is getting chased up the block. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Still rap about what you rap about. But
yeah. I mean, the thing now is that seeing when Meek, you heard him say like these similar things, but it's a whole different situation. Mm-hmm. I don't think in hip hop we've ever seen like an artist go to prison and have support from, it looks like, the whole entire country.
Right.
It's not just the people in the hood who enjoy his music. I mean, he's been flown from the prison to the Philadelphia 76ers playoff game know what I mean? Like, we haven't seen anything like that. So it's a larger conversation. And now that he's in a position to rub shoulders with all these billionaire people and all of that, mm-hmm. he does have a lot riding on him. But I don't think he's going to fumble at all.
Not at all. There's levels to it. It's not even just the justice system, right? So remember him speaking about battling this opioid addiction. That's a huge problem in the States, but being like, I was scared to tell my probation officer because I didn't want to go back to prison. Right. So he's addressing so many important issues right now. I just hope he keeps going.
And especially with the opioid issue, because that's always been a big issue in Philadelphia before it was fashionable to rap about it. They've been medicating themselves with syrup and pills and all of that. So for him to say that is going to show a lot of kids where he's from. And if you could win where you from, you're going to win amongst the world. So he'd be good.
Yeah, absolutely. With Meek, though, I'm looking at Meek so different from any other rapper. He got to keep that torch going, man. He got to keep that torch. Because we see people get out of jail. We see Kevin Gates get out of jail. Kevin Gates has now kind of been inspired a little bit by Meek to say, yeah, you got a couple bad, unfortunate incidents that landed you in jail for like months, if not like a year plus for Kevin Gates. Yeah, if you felt you were not rightly put there, like, you should speak out on it. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Meek is the epitome of, like, if you felt doubted, if people doubt you, you can. And that's been his whole entire brand. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's been fighting this case since he was 18 years old. He's 31. So it's like his whole entire narrative has been different instances of what he's gone through. So that can inspire somebody no matter what you're going through. It doesn't have to just be a prison thing, you know? I mean, the whole Dream Chasers brand is built on chasing what you want to go for, because he can show it. Like, you can actually go back to YouTube and see in 2006 or 2007 when these videos were uploaded of him rapping as a kid, and you can follow him every single year up until now.
Hey, one of the biggest things that this Meek thing has taught me is that, man, I don't care how y'all niggas be claiming y'all street rappers, y'all too real for this. Man, get y'all a couple good influential white friends, man. It'll definitely help things going. I'm telling you, because trust me, niggas always had the free Gucci t-shirts, but you know what it is? Gucci never was cool with the Atlanta Hawks, like, or I'm guessing, because I don't really know.
Right.
Like, owner that, I mean, the owner was putting his reputation. Imagine if it came back and was like, no, Meek did this and worse.
Yeah.
Everybody from Robert Kraft, the owner of course, just Kraft, but the owner of the Patriots, the owner of the 76ers. We have, he owns Kraft, the brand, you get me? And even the governor, everybody was stepping up to say, this is wrong. even the new DA is saying, we're rocking with Meek.
Right, but you know what that is? That's more of a testament as to who Meek is as a man, as opposed to an artist.
But also some association.
Because I mean, it's association, but I'm just saying, now look, I mean, I understand what you're saying, but at the same time, you got being an artist and being an individual is two different things. You know, a lot of people turn that artist button off when they're not around of an artist or not working. So it's like, people are supporting him for him, not because, I'm pretty sure all the people supporting him don't listen to all his music.
Yeah.
They just like him as a person.
I think they understand how important this fight is that he's a part of.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I agree with that. Mm-hmm. But, like, he was talking about how he met, like, the 76ers
owner
and how he met, like, Robert Kraft. And pretty much it was him kind of coming out of his comfort zone.
Yeah.
Right? Like, a lot of people, they will see situations like that, and they like keeping it, y'all want to keep it hood and street.
Yeah.
And it's the first time we've seen him at Sixers game kind of sitting close together. You never think that Meek was probably with him.
Yeah.
But they were friends for a while. And those people, in my opinion, they kind of got the wheels in motion for the rallies and stuff, because the fans going to be here. We wanted Meek out.
I'll tell you one thing, though. Like, if you're really from the street, that's the vision.
Yeah.
That's the evolution. Like, when you're in the street and you're coming from the street, you want to be in a position where you're in a higher place so that you can show people that still there is capable, too. Because all a person has to say is, like, yo, I lived in that same building, or I'm from that same block, so they can see themselves, like how kids seen the movie Black Panther.
Right.
They never seen an adaptation of a real superhero of themselves, so it's like Meek is like they superhero now for a lot of kids all over the country, even the world. Like, I'm pretty sure this shit goes on different levels in a lot of different places. You know?
Yeah. Look, not all superheroes wear capes, right? Just keep going, Meek, and we're here waiting for the music.
Right.
Drop an album in the next 3 months, though, man. It's too hot.
I mean,
hot
yo, look, so June is looking pretty stacked, right? I think he has some time if he wants to catch a breather. So, like, Drake, of course, has Scorpion coming soon, and, like, this guy's been on a run. So, between God's Plan and Nice for What, he was number one on the Billboard Hot 100 for 15 weeks straight. Aubrey and the Three Amigos tour coming in July, a collab with Bad Bunny on the way. Yo, heading into this new album, what's the temperature for Drake right now? I just feel like he can't lose at the moment.
Well, I'm gonna answer this question, and just right now as you're introducing it, I might have a take that you don't expect.
Okay, let's go.
The question really is this the biggest he's ever been? And I kind of think, no. I don't think this is the biggest he's ever been. I think we're seeing it manifest in the number ones, so we're like, oh, clearly it is. But streaming is set up for a nigga like Drake. I'm sorry to tell y'all. It's set up for Drake, okay? Drake owns the streaming era. I honestly think after Take Care going up to Views, that's the biggest Drake has ever been. And of course, like,
if we're just talking about Views and how people received that album compared to the temperature now.
No, okay. And this is what I got to define what I mean the biggest Drake has ever been. Mm-hmm. Where people are fiending for music. And like, on a mass scale, yeah. Right? I felt like up to that Views album, people were fiending.
They was fiending for Views.
They were fiending, they were right? Fiending. Even if they were let down, whatever. But they were fiending. Yeah. Now, Drake, I believe, he's cashing in on just his catalog, the unique type of artist he is, like, and the fact that streaming keeps getting bigger and bigger. Yeah. Drake dropped Nice for What, a song that I don't really enjoy that much. Like, I love it for
it's
the Lauryn
Hill. For you.
Right, but I love it for the Lauryn Hill sample.
Right.
That song is instantly number one. All right, let's even forget that song, because that's a single.
Right, but
He's on song with Lil Baby. Right. Yes, indeed. Drake had a 16, usually does like 32s. He'd be rapping for days.
Yeah.
That's gonna be a top 10 single. I could put money on it.
Right.
He's on Look Alive. That's
his song.
Okay, but whatever, but it was number two. But well, you know how the record industry works. Yeah. There's no money behind that record like a real Drake single. Right. So if Drake name is attached to anything and it's just flown to the top of the chart, it tells you, and you can see if you watch the Billboard Awards or if you just watch how he has dominated the charts,
right.
Drake owns this new streaming era. And
but you don't think that he's anticipated as much as he's been before?
More than Views?
All right, but look, now,
nah.
I think essentially he is because, okay, all that streaming shit is cool and all of that, but, all right, we're not judging the music based by the numbers, right? Just purely based by the numbers.
We're talking about the actual quality of
the
music,
yeah, the actual quality of the music, right? Now, I don't know if everybody agrees with me or not, but I don't, More Life is not one of my more favorite Drake albums. Like, yeah. It's not one of his better albums, right? Now, he has to outdo that shit. He asked, now forget the numbers. We already know what the numbers are going to do. He's going to be number one. He's going to have five number one. He's going to do all of that shit.
I'll do that shit, man. That nigga made a yeah, but I'm just saying, he better come from that UK.
But he has to come with some shit.
Yeah.
He has to come with some shit. Like, you can't just base what you think off of just purely numbers. We got to have some dope shit because people been falling. I ain't going to say they fell back off of him. I get what you're saying to an extent, but I feel like it's not pressure, but he has some shit where it's in his ear. Like,
I think there's a little pressure. I do think Views was a little disappointing. People didn't love More Life, although there are some joints. I feel like he's coming and he's trying to be consistent right now.
I think y'all be forgetting, man. After Take Care, that nigga was hitting feature after feature. Like, you know how we say, yo, Look Alive
was 7 years ago.
No, but that's what I'm saying. But I'm talking about in quality of music and people just wanting music and thinking that he's at his peak, right? Yeah. That was it. So I think that's what I'm saying, we're hypnotized by the numbers now. He didn't have a number one then. He never had a number one.
I'm not really hypnotized by the numbers, though. I just like the songs.
Yeah, we're not
okay.
The visuals
name the songs that Drake has dropped so far that you're like, oh, man, he's about to come back harder than he's
I'm not. He hasn't. He's only dropped two songs, which is God's Plan.
Which you love.
Yeah.
I love that song.
Diplomatic Immunity. Yeah, like Diplomatic Immunity. There's a few joints, but I'm just saying, like, he has to come with some shit. He hasn't come with none of those 5 a.m. In the morning rapping joints. He hasn't come with that. And he can always rap and sing, but shit got to go back to rap. No matter what, Drake knows he has to rap. Now you got Cole, who dropped his album. I'm pretty sure Kendrick is going to drop some shit again rapping. He's going to have to fucking rap and he's going to have to come with some shit.
Stop.
Drake. Stop what?
Drake can't compete with Cole. Cole bowed out of that race, man.
I'm not talking about competing with him in the see, you always talking about numbers.
No, not even numbers.
What?
Like, I feel like Cole just went this way. You feel me? Like, Drake... Drake, if we're just looking at
I'm talking about skill. I'm talking about skill.
Okay, so are you only talking about rapping? I'm talking about song making too. I'm talking about the entire thing.
I mean, song making is a good thing.
I feel like Cole hasn't done enough to keep up with someone like Drake or Kendrick.
I mean, but Cole, because
we're gonna talk about his album later.
Cole is not a main, like, he's not the mainstream. Or he's not wearing jewelry or none of that shit, or popping up in clubs and none of that. What I'm talking about is
my music.
All right, so look. But you're talking about the numbers of what he does. Fuck the numbers. Let's have a conversation about skill and rapping and okay, now song making.
The only way I could compare Cole and Drake at this point is just rapping. Song making, I ain't that impressed with Cole's song making recently, bro. And everybody called his last album trash. We're gonna get into it. I don't wanna just
jump into
that now, but like I feel like Drake, he hits, and we always say, right, Drake hits all the parameters. Like, you need a song for the chicks. Nice for what?
He's just also smart. So not even just the song, but then the visuals that go with it.
Yeah.
In the midst of the Me Too movement and shit, he's just kind of smart with the strategy. You got to give him that.
Yeah. He's great at strategy.
Aubrey, you good, man.
He's great at strategy.
Aubrey's just boxed out Chance, man. Chance was about to come with some stuff like that. Chance was reading Bible scriptures. He was about to come with that, and Drake just said, no, nigga, this is mine.
That was great, but I do feel like there is a bit of, like, something, a chip on his shoulder. He always acts like he has a chip on his shoulder when he makes an album. But I do think this shit is going to be anticipated because, at the same time, he's dropping the same month as a Kanye. And, I ain't even going to put Nas in there because Nas is Nas. His fan base is going to go to him for what they go to him for. Yeah. They're not going to pit him against Drake. But it's a lot of music dropping next month, and he wants to reign that shit. Yeah.
Of course. He is competitive. But I'm going to ask you the question as I was trying to make the point.
Okay.
And just give an easy answer.
Yeah.
So do you believe that the anticipation, forget the numbers, for just the music from Drake, that's about to come. Scorpion or whatever. Mm-hmm. Stole my shit, Drake. Anyway, before the stuff that's about to come.
Right.
Is more than views?
No. I don't think it's more than views, but you got to remember something. Views is what, 2 years ago, right? Mm. This shit is changing every 2 years.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like this shit is staying the same. Like, the way, even when you mention, well, not More Life, what is it? Take Care. It's like, I can't even mention Take Care in the same breath of what's going on today because everything was different at the time that he dropped Take Care. Mm. So now, yeah, because people was forgetting the last thing you did yesterday. They don't give a fuck. So if we're basing it off of More Life, right? We basing it off of More Life, hell yeah, because it's not people's favorite album from him.
I think Drake, for me, the only thing that he is still proven, and the thing that I would believe is driving him is that if we're clocking your run should have been up. You should have been about Wash City.
And that's the
right
thing.
Now.
He's just not, so consistent and adaptable. Like, when the Bad Bunny track like,
he's
drops,
not, yeah, he's the Hove of this generation. He is.
All right, hold on. But see, that's a conversation we can have in a whole different day. But like his run and where he's been a top artist for like literally.
Every
eight
year.
Eight years. Like, so if he's going to be the number one hottest artist for 10 years straight, again, I've always said this about Jay. We don't have that. I know.
Yeah.
Jay's always, he was always top three. You know what I mean?
Oh, top three.
Top three, top five. Yeah. Was Jay the hottest artist since Blueprint, the first Blueprint
no,
came
but,
up, all,
right, but
all
look,
the way to like
dropped, no, but
10
look,
years
he
after?
Dropped, he dropped. Wait up. He dropped an album for 96, 97, 98, 99.
I'm not talking about being consistent.
At 98 is when he really became the guy.
Man, Jay the Spurs, man. Come on, man.
See, now you see,
no,
you're
no,
trying
the
to
Spurs
take
are good. The
no, no, no,
good.
No, 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 no. Hold up, hold on, hold on. You're not going to do that shit. You're not going to do that shit because you're trying
no,
to take
Spurs are good, though.
You know that's an analogy that I've made before about something else that we'll talk
what?
About later. With the Spurs, you know, don't take my shit. Secondly, right? Don't take my shit. Secondly, you cannot call Jay the Spurs. You're out of your mind because nobody likes to watch the Spurs play.
No, not in that way.
So what are you talking
what
about?
What I mean is that what
he's
I mean
the
is
Bulls,
that
no, not what, the Spurs.
No. What I mean is that
what?
They're always good, but not all the time they get to the chip. Not all the time they win the chip, but they're always like the top three teams. You always got to mention the Spurs. Until now,
no, act your fucking.
Maybe
bugging.
You should never make basketball analysis.
Yeah, he can't. You can't
like,
keep doing this, bro.
No.
You can't keep doing this.
No. I'm not talking about. I'm not talking about in like entertainment factor.
You are talking about entertainment.
No, I'm talking about when we look at the top rappers.
Yeah.
I was just saying that the reason why it's hard to say Drake and Jay in terms of runs was Jay the number one. Name a year in the last 7 years that Drake wasn't undisputedly the number one. My bad. Where he wasn't the number one artist. Name 1 year. Where you like, yo, yeah, he was like number three or number four. You can't.
All right, well, look.
Wait.
Because it's arguable, because, all right, 2012, Kendrick dropped Good Kid, Mad City, and then Drake dropped, what was the shit with the sky next to
Nothing
him?
Nothing was the same.
Nothing was the same, and then Kendrick went on a nice run. That's why when you're going to equate Drake to being anticipated for views, that's because Kendrick was on his ass. He dropped three albums in that, well, two, right?
Man, it was Pimple Bop.
Stop what?
There is no year that we would get, if we did a run by run, year by year run.
Yeah.
Only last year would we ever say that, man, that might have been Kendrick here. Come on, man. Yo, you came off Take Care. Niggas was the hottest thing on the street.
He's still talking about Take Care.
Take Care, that was 2011. Are you kidding me?
Okay, but you mentioned Good Kid, Mad City. Okay, yeah. Then he drops Nothing Was the Same.
Nothing Was the Same. And then he drops To Pimp a Butterfly.
And come on, To Pimp a Butterfly was running the streets? Stop it.
The streets?
Wait, hold up.
Don't say the streets. Okay, then you're fucking it up.
What I mean is
fucking the package up when you say stuff like that.
The energy.
The energy. Yeah, To Pimp a Butterfly didn't have the energy. Are you kidding me?
That had the weight.
Yo, we can argue about Drake forever, but we gotta move on. I would say, though, the energy was different around views and real life.
We're not gonna talk about what you... Exactly, because look at the shit you listen to.
Yo, To Pimp a Butterfly, bro?
That wasn't a good album?
It was a classic album.
So what are you talking about? How you gonna say something was a classic album, but you saying I don't remember one song?
He's trying to say there were no, like, hits. It wasn't, like, radio. It wasn't in the club.
Because he's talking this number shit all the time.
No, it's not the number shit. It wasn't one of them joints, like... Like, for example, his last album, those songs are actually staying in the culture. Like, you could hear it running the shit. To Pimp a Butterfly, no.
He had some anthems there for, King like, Kunta. The social justice movement. But, yeah, right. Let's move on. We got a lot to talk about.
I got to chill out of that, man. I got to get on Instagram.
We can argue about Drake for the rest of the year if you want. Let's talk about Cardi, man. Like, after all the talk we did about Cardi on the show, we were off when she dropped Invasion of Privacy. So that debuted at number one. She sold more than 250,000 copies in first week. Every song appeared on the Hot 100 during the first week. What did you guys think? Highly anticipated project. How'd you feel about it?
I think she did exactly what she was supposed to do. When we was on here talking before, I said that I wanted to see her make a Love Is Blind type of record, and she did Be Careful, which wasn't the same exact, subject matter, but it was like similar and the same as to dealing with men.
What you think about that that reference track, bro?
The reference track? I mean, I'm about to get how I feel about the album. Now, I've only listened to Cardi's album like one or two times, right?
Really?
Yeah, if I'm only listening to it one or two in its entirety, yeah, top to bottom, one or two times. But the whole thing about Cardi's album is like, when I listen to it, all I think about is somebody saying this shit, like somebody else saying it. As far as like the ghostwriting aspect, like when I'm listening to it, I'm listening to it and I'm enjoying the music, but I'm always, something in the back of my mind is just like, I can hear somebody else saying it and her like reiterating it.
Have you felt that on her previous songs, like things before the album? I never really on this.
I mean, her previous songs was what, like Bardier, Cardi, and
yeah, like, but on the singles.
I really got introduced to her on I would say Bodak Yellow, but the other joint she had when she was like ran down on a bitch twice. That was the only songs I really knew. I wasn't really tuning in to Cardi, but like I never felt about those ones because I didn't know that they had writers in there that. You know
so
what I'm saying?
So knowing actually kind of ruins
like when I heard the reference track for Be Careful, I was like, damn, like the thing about Cardi, she just has the greatest delivery. Whatever you give to her, she just knows how to say the shit word for word to where it sounds like it's really coming from her, but you still like knowing that she
greatest
has writers.
Delivery or she owns it?
She has great delivery. She has great delivery. She owns it and she has great delivery. That's why you can take yourself out of the seat of saying, damn, somebody's writing this shit for her. But I'm just saying for me, because I work in music and all of that, I always listen to it like, I'm like, this is cool, but I'm listening to hear somebody else saying it. You know what I mean? Or how they said it for her to say it.
Okay.
I just got to say, salute to Cardi B. She's killing this pregnancy.
Absolutely.
Thing.
Changing the game for all of us, yo.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah. I think, you know what I mean? I seen her arguing, and I know I'm going to get into the album. I seen her arguing with Azealia Banks, and Azealia Banks was going on this
She got to stop.
Was like, yo, yo, she's setting back, I'm going to just say people of color, mm-hmm. because she acts ratchet. I'm like, nobody really gives Cardi B the props for being, usually when all women entertainers get pregnant, they go run and hide. You don't even see a bump. They don't even want to show you a bump because they want to remain sexy for the audience.
Right.
But I seen Cardi B twerking at Coachella, man. What a belly, man. You know, and it's not that she's twerking. It's that, like, she's living her life, still being public, still trying to do as much as she can while being pregnant, which is a normal thing that happens in life to women. So I love that. The album. Love the album. Not going to lie. I think Atlantic did the best thing with her, which is, I do. I love the album.
Okay.
Which is anti what everybody else is doing.
Mm-hmm.
Don't try to capitalize off her being so hot and give her 25 songs to get 500,000 sales first week. 255 is straight.
Yeah.
13 songs on the album. We heard like three or four of them already. Right. She previewed like the joints that we loved via the previews. That she promised to drop, they were on the album. Like the intro. There was
That was the intro though, wasn't it?
It was the intro and another one that we got Cardi and Bardier, Bodak Yellow.
Yeah.
And then we all knew like this was gonna be a song like Drake.
Yeah,
right?
I love her career. I don't love that album.
You don't love the album?
I don't love the album. Go ahead, Michael.
So some of the features though, the Migos thing made sense. We all know she rocks with them, right? That's her baby daddy and fiance. The Chance one, I was like, kind of okay with it. The Kalani one, it was cool. But honestly, for me, it's hard to sit back and be like, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, because I like a lot of the songs on there.
Yeah.
Or I'm like, they're cool.
But I mean, I don't say you have to say something's wrong for you to not be all into it. Like, you can say, this is just not for me. For me, I don't love her album. I think it's well put together, and it's good for what she needed to do. Mm-hmm. Like, it lived up to the expectations. I didn't expect her to drop some prolific, lyrical, classic album. You know what I mean? I expected her to drop an album based on the person who she is, and that's what it was. I love where she's going with her career because, honestly, for her to be a woman and for her to be a stripper, you know what I mean, a former stripper, and then going to being a reality TV star, once you go from one to the other, then they like, nobody's going to take you serious rapping. I didn't take her serious rapping, honestly. When I first heard her rapping, I was like, damn, they signing, nah, they bugging. But her personality is what took her career to the next level.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of people that have the talent, delivery, and all that, but when they're in the room, you don't know it.
Hey, what you said about when you listen to it, like you were thinking about other people saying it or whatever.
Yeah.
Certain records, you have a point. I know the Be Careful record, for me, I felt like, and that's why I said, she does have good delivery, or maybe even great delivery at times. Bodak Yellow, she fucking was in her pocket, right? In the bag. But on that Be Careful record, I loved what she did. I don't care if a nigga wrote it. You know why? It applied to her life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I love when artists takes what goes on in the media and don't tweet about it constantly. Like, put it in a song. I heard pain. I heard a woman that was hurt. I heard a woman that was fed up.
But that's why I said she needed to come with.
And she put it all in a song.
Right.
And I remember I tweeted out, but you know, a lot of people, like sometimes men are, they don't like admitting that they like songs like that. I loved it. She was, we already talk about her love life a lot.
Yeah.
She addressed it in a song, and I really love that song. Overall, I give the album.
Yeah, she did exactly what she was supposed to do.
And she's about to be selling strollers to moms in middle America. Thank you, Cardi. Changing the game for everybody. Guys, one day I could be pregnant sitting here between you two arguing.
Right.
Just kidding. That's never going to happen. All right, so...
What was your name, baby, at the meal? Or the meal name?
Livingston?
That's your name? Your name is Livingston?
Of course.
That's the most Jamaican name.
Exactly. Like a whole Jamaican dude.
Actually a British name. Jamaica's a...
But Jamaicans, I know a lot of Livingstons.
Oh, word?
Yo, Cameron used to walk around with a dread wig on. And when
Cameron
used to walk around with like the hat, the fake Jamaican hats with the dreads, walking around with this shit. And when people used to ask him what his name was, he used to be like, my name is Livingston.
Oh my God.
I'm dead serious.
My man Cam.
Wayno fun fact.
Wayno fun
fact. My man Cam,
yo. Also, happy belated.
Oh, thank
Axe birthday was last week.
Yeah, AK27.
AK27.
Even people said you've been 27 for like 5 years now.
Stage age.
Yeah, well, actually, somebody's, I'm 26 and a half. Like, I'm gonna be 26 and a half.
You age backwards?
I'm Beyonce age, man.
All right, B. All right, let's talk about this Post Malone album. So, yo, we always knew Post Malone was going to put up some serious numbers, but he really outdid himself. Beer Bongs and Bentley sold 460,000 copies week one, highest debut of 2018. Are you even surprised that he streamed this well, and do you like the project?
Remember what I just tell y'all about, like, this era is built for certain people in streaming? Mm-hmm. It's built for Post Malone. It's built for Drake. There's certain people, like, you could tell. Every time they get on a song, even though you might listen to a song and be like, this sounds okay, it's automatically at the number one spot. Mm. So when I saw his album come out, wasn't surprised at all. The entire album.
There's some joints.
Of course.
I don't like it as much as Stony, but there's some joints.
You know what? I'm a reserved judgment. Because you know what? When I first heard Stony, I listened to a lot of songs and I said they were cool. But I don't know if it's the radio. I don't know if it's just this Illuminati programming, man, but after I heard the song like 10,000 times, I'm like, this is fire.
Yeah.
This is fire.
Like, this, remember I told you I hadn't listened to a Post Malone album.
I was supposed to send you the Stony playlist.
Yeah, but
the intro.
I didn't even listen to this whole album. I listened to half of it, but listening to half of it, I understood what Post Malone meant a couple years ago when he made the comment about him saying, like, I'm not trying to be hip hop. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, he was like, I'm not trying
don't
to be
hip hop. No.
Huh?
Don't do that.
No, what are you talking about?
Don't tell me about defend that. No.
You said defend what?
Don't tell me you're going to defend that.
I'm not defending that. What I'm saying is that I'm understanding where he was trying to go with his music. Because when he first came out, I felt like he just ripped Yam's whole look. No, it's dead serious. I felt like he took ASAP Yam's entire look and he was just running with trying to be a dude in hip-hop, making a little bit of melodic songs.
Right.
But the way he's going with his songs now, it seems like he's not trying to be in no rap shit at all. Like,
I disagree with that, though. You know why? Because, like I listen to a lot of these newer guys, and, I mean, I even listen to, like, Trippie Redd at times.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, we know, Ak. I mean,
right. But not evident.
Yeah, I listen to Trippie Redd at times. But I listen to Trippie Redd, I listen to Uzi, and a lot of times, the way or the avenue they go with their melodies and cadences, like, it sounds like they're not in hip-hop either. I just think hip-hop is just so broad. We know hip-hop has now become the thing where it's like the definition of what they used to say porn is like, you don't know. Let me explain. Be like, how do you define it? You don't know how to define it, but you know it when you see it.
Wait,
and in
what?
This case,
what does that have to do with porn, my nigga?
I think that's they use the
analogy. Wait.
Look it up, bro. I can't help y'all with everything.
Listen. You know what hip-hop is today?
Hold on. You're not telling me. You can't fit Post Malone's music into no other genre but hip-hop. And hip-hop is really the cultural melting pot of all type of shit. It's not just rap and bars. So that's what I'm saying. When you're saying you accept him saying that he's not hip-hop,
I didn't see.
Or what other music you think he's playing?
I said that I understood what he was trying to say by saying that he wasn't trying to be just strictly rooted in hip-hop. That's what I'm saying. When he said this shit a few years ago, right? Like I said, I thought he was ripping ASAP Yam's look and was just taking and jumping in our shit to get hot and then just go elsewhere. But he was going elsewhere all along. Mm-hmm. The point I was trying to make is that hip-hop now is, we call hip-hop expression, right? If hip-hop is expression that comes from the streets, essentially, but the streets change as well. Everything changes, everything evolves. With Post Malone and how he does music, or Uzi or Trippie Redd, it's just full-on expression. So what I mean by that is now the lines is blurred between hip-hop and everything else. I thought that he was just in this shit trying to rip off of it at one point in time. But he already had a bigger vision for himself from the rip.
He's making songs
on a broader scale. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like, I mean, he dropped after, what was it? He had like a tape art or something.
I went to his first show
like
in
country
Santos.
Music.
Yeah, exactly.
Even, right? Like he went left for a minute.
Yeah, but you know, I only take exception to that because I got to keep these motherfuckers in hip-hop because they know they're profiting off of hip-hop. And what I want to embrace is that hip-hop is just expanding. You get me? And I don't want people to act like there's some other genre that's really giving the strength or the fuel behind these guys. Is really hip-hop. Like, Post Malone, his sound is very experimentative, right? Am I saying these words right,
experimentative.
Man?
I like when you come up with Livingston,
no,
you just be your best you. It's all
right. I can definitely
right
say my
L
name right. But, like, I see other artists doing it too. And I think if, like, for example, and this is gonna go left field again, like you guys.
Yeah, you ain't crazy.
No, like, Tyrese said this, right? Tyrese said, why is it when Sam Smith makes songs like what we make, but he's white, y'all call it pop, but when we do, y'all call it soul. Hmm. I think that if Post Malone was black singing those same songs, we're not saying he's not hip hop. Nigga, you're definitely hip hop. So you're not gonna, because you're white, you get to say, oh, I'm not making, no, nigga. You making what Uzi and them make sometimes. You make what Trippy and them do. There's a lot of dudes that sound or try to hit those cadences or whatever that you try to do. And you know what? Them motherfuckers cannot come to any stage or station and say, oh, I don't do hip hop. Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, but like if Post Malone was black, I don't even think he'd be like, that's a whole nother conversation.
White Iverson was, I thought it was a nigga. I thought it was a, you know, what's that guy that Martin played? One of the characters that he used to do on the Martin show, like the one team.
Oh, white, Bob from Accountant.
No.
That's what it was Bob from Accountant.
Not a ghetto dude. Jerome. Oh, Jerome. I thought it was like a Jerome type of dude, you know what I mean? I thought that's how he was going to look, like in terms of my perception when I heard the song. I'm like, this nigga is like idolizing Iverson? He's just saying white Iverson? So I thought he was going to look like that or look like Riff Raff. But.
Oh, Jesus.
For real, though. So when I saw him, I'm like, whatever. And then I saw his past. I don't know.
The thing about hip hop period is that like Post Malone, people just gotta accept the fact that he ain't going nowhere. I think a lot of these people aren't going anywhere. Like
Post ain't going nowhere.
Yeah, but that's the thing. It's like when we talk about hip hop, right? Because no matter where we are in hip hop, whether it's Atlanta, whatever, the conversation when you mention the word hip hop is always like the dude from New York on the corner. Like that's the narrative, like that's the person people always think of when they talk about hip hop. Those type of people just have to accept that this shit is expanding in a sense. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And understanding that like all types of people can jump into this shit. The reason why hip hop is expanding is because kids are expanding. Kids aren't in the streets anymore like they were prior. You know what I mean? So they're listening to different things. They're engaging in different things.
And just to wrap up that point about why I was like, I'm chaining this motherfucking hip hop. Lil Uzi and there's another rapper named Lil Tracy, they put out a country song, legit a country song. Mm-hmm. Sounds fire, right? That one record, if we're classifying a record by record, that's a country song.
Okay.
But you know, as an artist, if you go over their whole catalog, you would say, Uzi's still hip-hop. Mm-hmm. Lil Tracy, I'm still saying it's hip-hop. Whatever subgenre you get in, but it's still hip-hop. Same with Post Malone. You might have some songs about, yo, this sounds like really, some other stuff. Mm-hmm. You hip-hop, nigga. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
But country music is not influential to us. Hip-hop is influential to everything. Country music is not influential in the hood.
Yeah, they just sell the records. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but not all hip-hop music is influential.
But hip hop as a culture is the most influential thing. Period.
You're right, but I think that's where we're dealing with this new adaptation of this new music. Like again, hip hop used to really come from people who had pain, who really.
It still does.
Yeah, but
it still does.
But now it's coming from people or kids in the suburbs who are just going through addiction problems.
But they're going,
mental it's depression and all these other things that usually we never heard. Be the prominent thing. It was about being broke. It was about being oppressed. It wasn't about being like, okay, you know what? I'm just
sad. Man, it's always been about rags to riches. You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. going from nothing to something. And it's still that. I mean, even with the kids that, the problem is that we look at people in the suburbs like they don't have no problems. Everybody has problems throughout the world. Like there is no, hardship is not, hardship doesn't discriminate. I mean, everybody experiences ups and downs no matter what. Mm-hmm. I just think that a lot of the kids, like the Trippies and all of that, or X, I say, X is like a person that's not afraid to express the shit he's going through personally. And it's other people here. He's understood that there's people that feel like that everywhere, so he taps into that shit. Mm-hmm. A lot of people in hip-hop, in the hood, in the streets, they got a lot of mental health issues, they got a lot of personal issues, but they be scared to talk about it because in hip-hop, also that shit is looked at as weak.
We're super judgmental as a culture.
Absolutely.
But So we're going to talk about Childish Gambino, and I feel like we need to add him as a topic for another day because he's so interesting to me. I'm curious if you guys were into his music like a few years back when he was dropping those EPs. I feel like hip-hop didn't embrace him like they did now. Not even close. Right? You know what I mean? His audience was very different, I'll say that. But more on that later. So anyway, of course, he debuted This Is America on SNL in May and released a video the same night. First number one song, first top 10 on the Billboard Hot 100. Let's take a look. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping up. Look how I'm geeking up. He bodied that.
Yeah, bodied that Uzi shoulder roll. I kid you that.
I didn't even know he had moves like that. What do you guys think of this overall and just like the run he's on right now? Music, TV, film, music. It's pretty incredible.
Times like this, and I think this definitely goes unnoticed, but this time we're in suits people like him.
Right. Whereas five years ago was a different conversation for him.
Yeah, like think about even 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. Like very different. But even suits, like it suits a wide variety of artists, like the Jaden Smiths, like the people who aren't just in a box and be like, yo, I just do this because traditionally that's what we do.
Right.
You get me? These are the people who are experimenting. These are the people who are blurring lines. And it's crazy to see how visually now we're seeing a lot of important songs or songs become even more important through their visuals. And it's not just, yo, it's a traditional music video. We just spent $1 million. So you see helicopters bringing people.
The Cash Money era is over. Except for Lil Pump.
Exactly. Yeah. So very powerful video. The song is dope. I've talked to a bunch of people about this song and everybody seemed to have a different, they drew away something different from the video, which already says, that's genius in itself.
Right.
You get me?
Well, I know we're going to get on another day, but like me personally, I didn't really like Childish Gambino a few years ago because I didn't understand him.
Until you heard Redbone, man.
Nah, it wasn't even Redbone. Like, I just really didn't understand who he was. At that time, I still was on my super, I want to hear 100 bars shit. Like, you know what I mean? I still was on that type of way.
People knew him for comedy. He had like a couple EPs. And the music was good. It was just so different. I feel like he did not have this core rap audience that he has now.
I remember he was on stage one time overseas and he said that, yo, I'm the best rapper out here. And everybody in the club said, shut the fuck up. Yeah. Because like we were like, yo, bro, we don't even listen to you like that, right? Because it wasn't that time. Right.
I wasn't into the whole shit of like people who weren't rappers jumping in to be rappers. Mm-hmm. But when I think of Childish Gambino, honestly, I really started getting into everything he does over the past year and a half because I just started watching Atlanta on the second season. I didn't watch the first one. And I feel like he's one of the greatest entertainers, period, that we're going to see in a long time. It's like, imagine if at one point in time, Spike Lee was rapping.
Right.
When he was making all of the films that he was making that was bringing up different types of conversations. The thing about this video that's so dope is it brings up a lot of...
Imagine Academics is rapping.
Huh?
Imagine Academics is rapping.
We're going to get to Lil AK. Right. We're going to open with it tomorrow.
Right, but just to see where he's at, like the video brings up so many different conversations, and I love the fact that he's like, yo, I don't want to talk about it.
Yep.
He's like, I don't have anything to say because it's stirring conversations because he's killing black people in the video, but he's using guns. There's so many different ways you can go with that conversation. Right. So I just salute him for everything he's doing as an entertainer, period.
That's real art. All right, more Gambino later. Finally, J. Cole, looks like we're going to get to Kanye and all of that later in the week as well. So J. Cole, of course, returned with KOD. 397,000 copies moved first week. He broke Spotify and Apple Music first week streaming records. He's going on tour with Young Thug. He announced his first annual Dreamville Festival.
Right.
Cole is back. Did you guys like this project?
See, this is why I'm saying where Axe stole my shit about the Spurs.
Oh, that's where you got it from?
Yeah, that's where he got it from because we had a conversation before.
Akademiks.
We had to look at his face. Yeah, look at his fucking face.
His fake confused.
Like that blink, right?
You don't believe this guy, man?
Yeah, they're going to believe me because people know I know more about basketball than you do.
Okay.
First and foremost, right?
I'm calling secondly, bored in a good way.
No.
I call him Napkin Cole. You know what I mean? Put niggas to sleep.
But what I said about J. Cole was, before Act took my shit, was that I equated him to the San Antonio Spurs because they get all the accolades, they get all the trophies, but nobody ever rushes home to say, I want to see them play. That's why I say
just call him NyQuil, bro. Right?
Whatever. Now, when it comes to the KOD album, I actually like the KOD album. No, it's not an album I could throw that shit on at any moment, but I did like a lot of the things that he talked about. And then when he put out the interview with Angie, to know that he had addiction problems with alcoholism. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know that about Cole. I didn't really, even when he was saying it, I was thinking that he was talking from somebody else's perspective,
right,
not his own. I liked his album overall. You know, I know it's an issue about the production and all of that because he keeps doing his own beats.
Yeah, I think he need to give it up, man. You gotta give it up. By the way,
give what up? Give up his own beats?
Give up this whole no features, no nothing. He's like, he's like Russ, except he don't really say it. The fans say it for him.
Did you hear why he said the thing about the feature when he did feature himself, why he did that?
No.
All right, well, so the whole the Kill Edward shit was his step-pop's name is Edward. Mm-hmm. And he had this, he's like, I don't want to literally kill my step-pops, but it's a lot of shit that fucked me up as a child that made me the way I am with my bad shit. So I wanted, he said he wanted to find a way to express that. That's why he featured himself. I thought that was pretty
dope. I thought you were saying why he was explaining why he don't use features.
No. He was saying that, and then he was just saying, he was like, maybe I would jump into doing features again, but he's like, I just be wanting to express my own shit on my shit. I don't really want to do songs at this time with other people. Like, he's just into his own thing.
Yeah, which is fair enough.
I respect that. The album was great. Great album. And I will say, great for the rapping was top tier, mm-hmm, as you would expect. The content and the stuff he was addressing, very important messages that were sent, that were cleverly, it wasn't like corny. Mm-hmm. And it's just, I had to throw that out before I could give any criticism, right? I don't like the production on the shit, man. It feels like, man, J. Cole, I heard him say, he was explaining, like, I think it might have been on the Angie interview, like, or no, it was on Twitter, it was responding to a fan, and he said he's using the same snare for like 8 years. I'm like, nigga, I could hear it. You feel me? Like, bro, switch it up a little bit. Just in production.
Yeah.
Just in production. I would like to hear him over different beats, different bops, different type of things.
I got a question. I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off, but look, so in terms of now, I want to have a numbers conversation.
Yeah.
Because in terms of the numbers, if he broke all these records, doing the shit that he does, if it's not broke, do you fix it, essentially? Because maybe he feels like, my shit ain't broke. If we basing off numbers, because he setting all types of records and then Post broke his record, but...
Yeah. Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. But that's only, and you know what I mean?
Before what?
I understand. Well, he already said he bowed out of the conversation of, like, really trying to compete in terms of who's the, like, whoever people think is the number one, right?
Yeah, yeah.
He said that. He said he competes with himself, he ain't really worried about these other niggas, and he don't care to be whatever.
Right.
But honestly, to really compete in my eye, like a fan's eye, I think you gotta do a little bit more, man. You can't just like stay in your pocket. You kinda gotta experiment a little bit. You kinda gotta jump out there and fuck with other people. You can't just be in one lane. And again, if it's not broke, don't fix it. But people get tired of the same shit, man. If we're only looking at numbers, fine. But that's what I'm saying.
Are they tired? I mean, of course, now, these is not... Sales is different now. This is not people, like, going to the store and actually physically buying the shit. This is people just continuously listening to it over and over.
But he's always had, like, a wildly loyal fan base.
Yeah, he has a wildly loyal fan base. So is... Does he have... That's what I'm saying. Like, does he have to? Because if you look at him in terms of success, he's just as successful, if not more successful, than everybody that we would put him against in the competition question.
He would be way more successful. That's what I'm saying. But that's, yo, he would be way more successful.
But all right, but that's a personal issue within himself.
Yeah, so it's like his terms of successful. Cole has obviously been through some shit that caused him to recede into his shell. So he pops out, he'll do the HBO special, he'll drop the album. You know what I mean? Clearly, he's made a conscious decision, like, this is where I want to be.
And that's why I said I respect him for it. Because even his limited explanation at times,
right,
I respect it because it seems like, it seems genuine, mm-hmm, on his part. I'm just, mm-hmm, saying, as a fan wanting more.
You want to hear some different shit.
You
want that J. Cole little pump feature.
No, not even. And because I'm a fan who like, you know what? This is what fans do. We like an artist or we like a group of artists, yeah, and we talk shit. Like, me and you will sit, this is what we do on the show.
Absolutely.
We'll sit and we'll argue about it. Like, Cole gave me a little bit more fuel, like, to actually get at, you know what I mean?
I wish he would be a little bit more direct with certain shit, too, because even with, like, 1985, right? Everybody feels like 1985 is attacking the Trippies, the Littles, mm-hmm, the Zans. They're attacking the whole younger generation. It's a lot of shit in there that's about a lot of artists, period. it's not, I don't think it's at, like, Lil Pump was a small part of it, mm-hmm. right? He was a small part of it. But if you think about what he's talking about, that's kind of a continuation of what Jay was saying on 444. You know what I mean? About pawning all your, like, bringing back your cars and bringing back your chains. And, you know what I mean? You back on your taxes. And even what he's saying, like, well, damn, what I can't get a line out of 1985 at the moment. But he was saying a lot of shit to that same narrative about not spending your money wisely, not buying a house and investing in yourself.
Blowing it all now in 5 years, realizing if your hot streak's over, it's really over for
and,
you.
Absolutely. And that's not just dudes. My fault. That's not just dudes. That's the littles. That's not just them.
Hey, I don't know what year J. Cole is in, but nigga, ending up on Love & Hip Hop ain't that bad of a move these days.
Academiks.
On some real shit. Come on, Cardi came from Love & Hip Hop. Love & Hip Hop is kind of not...
All right, so
it used to be the graveyard. Love & Hip Hop right, might reinvigorate
a
nigga.
That's one out of how many?
She's a unicorn.
Yeah,
she's
that's one out of how... That's lightning.
Cardi, Kate Michelle came out of there.
That's lightning in a bottle.
You saw Ray J over there. Soulja Boy was over there. You know what I mean? Shit, Joe... Yo, there's a lot... What I'm saying is, we used to look at Love & Hip Hop as that's only the place for Instagram models and, like, almost hip-hop wives. It's different.
But that shit is still outrageous sometimes to be on because the thing that I don't have a problem with, Love, like, honestly, I watch that shit from time to time because it's like a comic book. But, it's like, for real, this shit is like a comic book. The only problem I have with shit with Love & Hip Hop is that it always shows women of color being confrontational. That's what I don't like about a lot of reality TV. Huh?
We love beef. That's
we. Beef. I'm not talking about we. I'm talking about myself. Me, myself, being a father of daughters, like, you can't...
Wait, what? You don't watch reality TV to see confrontations?
What I'm saying is that I don't always watch that shit. I'm not a person that's tuned into every reality show. What I'm saying is that when I turn on 11 Hip Hop or Basketball Wives or a bunch of other different shows, it's always the same. They just sitting at lunch with no lunch. It's just water. And then they're arguing, and then they're throwing water on each other. And what people fail to realize is that
they
shit...
They plastic cup shit? They got to do that, man.
Right. Why but you got glass? What I'm saying is people don't realize that shit has an effect on people who watch that shit. So other girls is going to act like that. Other girls might only aspire to be certain people. Now, Cardi, like I said, that's lightning in the bottle. She got some shit that everybody else ain't have. Like, to be Cardi, you had to go through what Cardi went through.
Right.
But it's little girls that's going to see that shit that's going to feel like, oh, I could do the same shit. I just got to act this way.
Mm-hmm.
And they could look at anybody on that shit that ain't the lightning in the bottle to act that way.
Hey, I like how everybody played 1985. I was a little bit nervous at first because, and also there's a part of me saying, man, Cole, why don't you just say fuck Lil Pump? He used to say fuck you.
Oh, yeah, you always want to hear your name, right?
But he did it right as an OG, right? He kind of gave advice. Kind of a little bit of a diss too, you know what I mean? Son of them or son of whatever you call it. But like, he's reached out to them. Like, he's reached out to Pump. Yeah. Like, people saw Pump at his, by the stage at Rolling Loud, and they just assumed, like, yo, what's going on here? Like, they had a conversation.
Nobody's gonna go.
Right? And no.
Yeah.
And Cole genuinely fucks with him. You get me? Like, they had conversations.
He don't have a reason not to.
Right? Mm-hmm. And Cole's thing is, I'm just trying to give some advice. And hopefully you didn't take it too offensive where you think I'm coming at your neck, but that's just me, the OG, trying to give you some advice. Yeah. There's a lot of rappers that he addressed on there. Mm-hmm. He wasn't direct at all in terms of saying that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
As he mentioned black skin at one point, clearly Pump ain't black. He mentioned some other things you could really attribute to a lot of people, but really you should look at it as really, I'm not a rapper that's as old as Jay,
mm-hmm.
but a rapper who's been very seasoned. He's a vet. And he's saying, yo, this is how we do
we
it.
Got, damn, Cole got almost 10 years in.
Yeah,
well, he does have 10 years in, right?
He does, right?
So I thought it was great how he handled that. And I was very nervous how the newer rappers who are usually like, yo, if it's a diss to me, I'll just say fuck him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
None of them really, they kind of did it how they could do it. They're all young.
Yeah.
We're going to troll and, yo, I'm a lyricist, whatever, whatever. But you saw slowly, like, Lil Pump. Maybe would have never publicized it, right? Because it's not lean or Percocets or whatever else he would have, or new chain. He said, no, I just got a new house. Just to let you guys know, like, I'm doing some stuff right. And yeah, whether it was J. Cole that inspired that or J. Cole inspired him to show us that.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It shows the maturity that's happening with these rappers through the music.
The only thing I would like to not see, I would like to see less of the disrespect. Because the thing is that, like, whenever somebody says somebody's name, they go full on disrespect. Like, you got Woe Vicky holding fucking AK-47s at cameras and shit. Like, this shit is out of hand, yo. Yeah. Like, it's totally out of hand.
Cloud chasing should be an Olympic sport, man.
People gonna die cloud chasing. But the whole fact of the matter is that if a person expresses their opinion, they don't have to be disrespected for you to get them to understand your standpoint.
It might take a lot for us to get to that point.
It's going to take a long while because this shit is getting bad about a minute.
But on the bright side, Young Thug going on tour with Cole.
I didn't want to hear
that's lit.
My guys.
Hold on. Back to the last topic. I did want to hear what Cole had to say about Ye because apparently Ye was feeling like there was some tension there.
What he said about Ye was real.
I was wondering, but still, I want to see where that relationship is at because if I'm listening to Cole, Cole's not the type of person who just comments from afar. Right, there's a lot of people who make commentary from afar, never really talking to the person. If he said that about the littles, right, and he's reaching out and he's talking to them behind the scenes, whether we see it or not, did he try to reach out to Kanye, and how is Kanye receptive to that?
They spoke. Did you watch the Angie Martinez interview, my nigga?
Like, I don't know.
This is what I'm saying. So you would have understood where he was coming from because he talked about when he got on the phone with him.
I seen it in clips.
No, but that's what I'm saying. When he talks about the shit in its entirety, right? When he talks about the shit in its entirety, they don't have a relationship. Like, people can't associate them just because it's Rock Nation, Rockefeller, all of that shit. Right.
But he don't got a relationship with Pump.
He doesn't have a relationship with Pump. I'm just saying that when he spoke about Kanye, he basically was saying, like, yo, this shit is real, and you can't just be out here just saying shit. Because if you're just saying shit and you're that influential, you got people that's really going to run behind what you say and not knowing how it's affecting the people that's on the ground level. So you got to be careful. This shit is still a responsibility.
Well, I just think it should be a reaching out type of thing going on.
That's what happened. They spoke.
Kanye looks like he's going through a lot right now. But we'll get to him. So let's close
with
this.
He's still wearing Yeezys, though, right?
I thought you were going to boycott.
Yeah. No, I ain't said yet. I said if he said one more crazy thing, man.
Academiks. Bro, you were.
Yeah, he got 6 months. Put out an album, No More Crazy Things.
All right, so let's close with this. So we were speaking about the Cole album. You feel like the production can get a little bit monotonous, so Russ feels the same way. So he did an interview with DJ Vlad in 2016 where he says, basically, music being whack is on the producers. They're making beats that sound the same. Let's take a look.
Why should we blame producers instead of rappers for whack songs?
See, people think that, like, you blame the rappers for the state of hip-hop. Rappers are not making the music. You gotta blame the producers. Producers are making whack shit. If all I do is rap, I'm a vocalist, and a producer sends me a pack of 20 beats and they're all whack and they all sound the same, I'm just fucked. I gotta pick the best of the worst. It's not the rapper's fault. You know what I'm saying? Like, listen to the beat.
So, of course, people felt a way about this. So he clarified it by still being, let me address this 2016 interview since y'all getting emotional because the only way he knows how to address people, I was referring to the monotony in production. 95% of the beats and raps sound the same. 95% of rappers do the same shit. Blah, 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 et cetera, et cetera. If it doesn't apply, I wasn't talking about you. So, of course, Metro was one of the people who wasn't feeling this. He said that Russ is whack in spirit. But do you agree with his message here?
I'll go first for a second. As I really don't know much about Russ. I never really heard too much of his music. You know what I mean? What I feel on this whole shit is, I feel like it's a little bit of truth to what he's saying. A small amount. Because he does have a point with certain producers doing certain things. Now in rap, when kids turn on whatever they turn on, and they see somebody doing something, and they see them with money, rap is going to becoming just a money grab as opposed to a craft and a profession. Well, I wouldn't say a profession, but I say a craft. People don't work on skill. So kids say, oh, they doing that shit. They getting money. I'm going to do that, and I'm going to get money. So they try to emulate whatever they think is going to get them some bread, which they don't work on the other things that even made it possible for you to get bread off the dumb shit.
Right.
So I do agree in a small space there. But you can't blame a producer for a rapper saying some trash shit just because he has if a producer sent you 20 whack beats, find another producer. Mm. You know?
Man, Russ tripping, bro. I ain't gonna lie. Russ, by the way, if we're gonna blame or put blame somewhere for quote unquote whack music, two people in my mind, or one's one people, and then a thing, internet. The internet, as you said, has made it so easy, anybody could do it.
All right.
So the skill level required and also the entry points that are necessary to make music are very low. $100, you can buy some shit, you're putting out music on SoundCloud, right? Then on top of that, you have to blame really the consumers. The consumers do like the fast food music. The stuff that is a little bit more in depth, that takes longer, they don't want. Or not to say not all of them, but they don't want to eat up as quickly or even live with it because they even move on from that quick enough.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's people that have moved on from a J. Cole album. It's heavy. It's loaded with shit. Niggas moved on from the 4-4. You could go back to 4-4-4 and probably still get some shit that you missed. But people seem to move on. We're in a generation, and the new generation, which usually dictates the a lot of the popping music, they want shit that, shit, on Instagram, if it don't pop in 60 seconds, I'm out of here.
Right?
So I'm going to blame them. With Russ, Russ likes to big himself up by shitting on other people. And that's the reason why he's disliked. Why did you say this? You know why you said this? Russ is trying to let people know, I don't make beats like them other niggas. And also, y'all know why y'all like my music? I produce my own beats.
But that's right.
He's a walking billboard for promoting this whole DIY thing.
Yeah.
And I fuck with him. Like, he's talented. Great. Super talented.
Does he sell his beat? Has anybody rapped on a Russ beat other than Russ?
No, but his thing is that, look, y'all give all these. At one point, he did retract it when he came on the show. He said, oh no, you can't even compare me to Cole because Cole only does like these two things. I also engineer it, I master it. He basically says he does everything, including carrying the CD to the store. So pretty much.
He just was feeling himself in this comment.
But that's.
Always.
That's right. Mood all summer 18, trust me.
Right. Like,
all his life. He's done that. And he shitted on producers. And honestly, I just don't think the producers are to blame. I think he needs to chill with doing that to kind of highlight his skills. He sees himself not, like people just say, okay, you're dope. Or people just hate him and call him whack, right?
Yeah.
And he probably sees that things he does doesn't get the necessary shine, so he shits on other people. Anyway, it's an old interview. I'll bring up another point. Sunny Digital.
Yeah.
He got on Twitter, and he made a different point. And it was a little odd seeing him make that point, but I also disagree with his point. He said, yo, you know who we're supposed to, like most of these producers are trash, mm-hmm. and he's a producer. Mm-hmm. No, it wasn't Sunny Digital. I posted on my page. But he said it was the engineer. He says these beats nowadays are trash. No, it was OG Macko.
So everyone just passing blame
on OG Macko. Yeah, OG Macko. He says these current beats are trash. It's the engineer who's actually tweaking the beat and adding certain stuff that when you hear the beat,
it sounds
phenomenal.
My question is
And again, it's again shitting on the producers. I don't believe that. If we're going to say the engineer, and not that the engineer does tweak beats, and
right.
I know a lot of engineers that will make a decent beat, start slapping, they start adding cuts, and right, they do all that, right? But why are we talking about the engineers, like, giving all these dudes that we like their sound? Who is Travis Scott engineer? Like, there's all these people we like their sound. They are engineer created. So why are we attacking the producers instead of the vocalist? For the same reason we started this conversation out.
Mm-hmm.
How did a producer's beat make you say some whack shit?
Yeah.
It's the vocalist, nigga. You're in there.
If you write some
whack shit.
If you write whack shit, yo, if you fucking whack, you whack. It doesn't matter what type. Like, honestly, I remember Jadakiss said this shit. He said, y'all need beats for help. We help the beats, right? So that, with him being one of the top tier lyricists of our time, of any generation of hip hop period, and saying something like that, it's all about what you have to say. And a lot of these people ain't saying shit. And my thing is even if you ain't saying shit, because there's always been rappers that ain't say shit,
right.
You got to at least make it sound feasible. You at least got to make it sound good. And everybody, I don't know who specifically he was talking about or what he was talking about at that point in time, because there is a lot of trash shit, but there is a lot of good shit. I hear what you're saying about people moving on, but everybody hasn't moved on from the Cole album. I don't think now we can really even see how people are consuming until they're on the next project, because you got a lot of young kids that want to hear the shit that they want to hear. But you got a lot of kids that's in college that want to hear Cole. You got a lot of people that's in the streets that want to hear Drake shit and want to hear Cole. Like, it's so mixed that it's just always going up, always. Like,
well, that's like, just a wrap.
You can't even monitor the shit almost.
And you're right. Just a wrap. I want people to stop blaming producers. These producers are single-handedly carrying most of these songs nowadays. Almost 95% of the work is done by the beat.
And can I rap with something as well? I want to say that y'all got to fucking respect these producers, because artists never want to pay them. You know what I mean? They got to give out 20 beats to sell a discounted one. And without producers, there is no raps. Because you can have all the raps in the world, but if you have no production, which is the foundation of music, you have no music.
Word. Yo, shout out to Metro. Don't ever be whacking spirit, y'all. Everyday Struggle, we'll be back. We'll see you here tomorrow, 11 a.m. on Compass News. Yeah.